that's great. Now we have to go over to the next issues. We're going to be talking about non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Basically, this is a very exciting time, not only in CLL, but also in non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, with many new and emerging agents. An important goal of therapy is to improve outcomes while reducing patients' exposure to toxic therapies, particularly in challenging cases, patients such as elderly and those with refractory disease. So in this segment, we'll discuss how the latest research impacts treatment strategies for various subtypes of NHL. And with respect to this, let's start out with indolent B-cell lymphoma. And since my colleagues are really one of a cast of wonderful CLL, they do some lymphoma, I'm going to take on, I guess, a few of these things, and I'm open to criticism or comments at any time. So what is the approach to initial therapy of follicular lymphoma? And for example, what is the current standard and what treatments do we utilize? I think that just a few years ago, there has always been a debate with R-CHOP, R-CVP. We used in the past fludarabine-based regimens. Fludarabine is now kind of out of sync only because the concern of the leukemiogenesis. We know that from Rummel, from the trial, the STILL trial, was that they showed that betamustine Rituxan was better than, say, R-CHOP in a randomized study of indolent and mantle cell lymphoma, and based on that, and also what we call the BRIGHT study, which is a little different. They compared actually upfront betamustine Rituxan to either RCP or R-CHOP, so each site decided which one they use, and there is a difference. And the Italians did a study where they actually, when they compared fludarabine FMR to R-CHOP and actually to RCVP, that the RCVP gave the outcomes were not as good with respect to progression-free survival, and that either the fludarabine-based regimen, I believe it was FMR versus R-CHOP, actually had better outcomes. However, due to toxicities, it was felt that R-CHOP was actually better. We have to keep in mind that in the upfront study from Rummel, they only include follicular lymphoma grade 1 and 2, not 3A, and especially 3B, 3B being actually very aggressive, and believe we should be treating actually that 3B should be treated with anthracycline-based therapy. Now, that's one issue that comes up in the NCCN guidelines in the past year, is that depending on your hematopathologist, it may be very difficult to determine what is 3A and 3B. So sometimes if you have a patient with advanced disease, symptomatic bulky tumor, if it's a 3A, we might want to consider using the anthracycline-based therapy. So this is a little bit tough. I believe that a lot of the data, a lot of actually different information where they've actually sent out questionnaires to both practicing clinicians and as well as in academic centers, that really betamustine rituxan is being used much more than, say, any other regimen at this time. It is less toxic. We don't have a lot of long-term follow-up. There's been a question whether or not, if you have a younger patient, can you actually, if they need to go to auto transplant, can you collect stem cells? That doesn't seem to come out as a major problem at this point. So in my own practice, and I believe that betamustine rituxan is well tolerated and actually utilize a fair amount of it. If I have certain factors such as really, even though it might not be true, I think it's just a gestalt, if I have patients that have they have 3A or they have a combination or a more aggressive type of nature, the lymphoma is actually aggressing more rapidly than, say, an indolent type would be with, say, serial scans or exams. I tend to use a more aggressive, R-CHOP has been around for decades. Rituxan betamustine has only been around for a few years. So in those cases, or if I have a patient which has got very bad disease that I might consider autotransplant, even though there's no data saying that betamustine rituxan will inhibit the ability to collect, I think there still is a general acceptance that R-CHOP, from the initial trials we did, you can collect stem cells without difficulty. It's less suppressive to the marrow. So I believe that really R-Benda has really taken over as first line until we find R-Benda plus, perhaps, or using that as our anchor, what other things can we combine, say, to actually get even better outcomes? And what is the potential use of chemo-free regimens? Well, that's the very exciting time, because with respect to the looking at work that initiated by Fowler at MD Anderson, the Revlimid, the lenalidomide rituximab data, not only in the relapse setting, but also now in the upfront setting with a very large 1,000-patient study that has accrued now, both Europe and U.S., looking at basically what we call R-squared, lenalidomide Revlimid plus rituximab, versus actually dealer's choice. And they included either R-CHOP, R-CVP, or bendamustine rituximab, where a lot of other studies. I think that would be very exciting. And those two arms would either be continued by some additional, and those responders with additional R-squared or rituximab maintenance therapy. I think that's going to be one of the biggest trials to show us that what we call, even though they call them chemo-free, we still have toxicities with these novel agents, but it'll be very exciting because of the toxicity profiles and also, I think, long-term outcome. I don't think that we should be utilizing these in practice just yet in the community, but I think that we're going to be seeing some exciting things happening. What about transplant in the patients with low-grade lymphoma? I can tell you that really for years we've known that allogeneic stem cell transplant, because of graft versus lymphoma effect, can be potentially curative, not only in the indolent, but also in CLL. But to use it and potential risks of developing chronic graft versus host disease or other complications, even in the non-myeloablative approach, is that you really have to select out the patients for stem cell. Autotransplant is utilized. We don't get any benefit of, say, getting a new immune system or new T cells, but can be used in patients that have very aggressive disease that have actually refractory disease. What's exciting now is all the agents that we talked about in CLL, a lot of these agents being utilized in the indolent lymphoma setting, where I think actually we're delaying now going these patients into autologous stem cell transplant because we can try these novel treatments and actually extend the, actually get them in remission because of the decrease or lack of cross-resistance that we used to see because the drugs were very similar, alkylating agents or purine analogs with a different purine analog. Things are really changing and very exciting. So some of the issues are, as we know, we're using idelalisib, and it was FDA approved as a single agent just recently, as a single agent in patients with either relapsed follicular lymphoma or relapsed small lymphocytic lymphoma. We did mention earlier, but idelalisib also was approved with combination, basically with rituximab, in patients with relapsed CLL. I think that, again, we're increasing the number of agents in our armamentarium. It's only going to benefit patients. What I think we lack and what we need to do not only, and maybe it's done better in CLL, is that we need longitudinal long-term follow-up on our patients to gain a better understanding of how we should be sequencing these different therapies. In other words, we don't want to burn bridges. We want to maintain patients' quality of life. I think there's been a recent issue that came up that was a statement that was made from like the intergroup and Alliance that maybe what the NIH would like to see is that maybe with these novel therapies, maybe the approach of novel treatment protocols and studies is to look at obtaining not only minimal residual disease, but potentially looking at these agents and achieving the potential of a curative approach. Because we can always do palliative approaches, which I think actually is good for the elderly patients. But in a young, healthy patient, we may have the potential today with all these novel agents of going into curing a significant subset. Don't have it today.